when I was a child that my interest in the violin would save my life. When I was young, my father used to take me to the barber shop where there were three barbers, and on the wall was a violin and a bow. And when one of the barbers didn't have a customer, he would take down the violin and bow and play popular songs. And the other barbers would sing along. And I was so enchanted with the sound of the violin. Upon returning home, I picked up two sticks, making believe that I was playing the violin and singing just like the barbers. And this continued for some time. When I reached the age of 7, I was stricken with scarlet fever. And my parents, knowing what the violin meant to me, kept telling me, "You get better and we'll get you a violin." And I recuperated. And my parents kept their promise. And my father took me to the best teacher in Warsaw. I made great progress. Everybody was proud of me. People spoke to my parents of my talent. And after 9 months, I had already played a recital at the Chopin Academy in Warsaw. And one of the most significant experiences happened when I was 9. My father took me to a concert of the Warsaw Philharmonic with Ephraim Zimbalist playing the Beethoven Violin Concerto. And this experience impressed me so much that it became my dream to study with this great artist. And the war started in 1939, when I was 12 years old. And I am convinced that without the love and devotion of my family in those early years, I could not have survived the tortured existence in the Nazi concentration camps. I am the sole survivor of my family. I attribute my survival to the violin. In 1943, the Nazis selected 105 people deemed young, sick, and old to be executed by firing squad. And being in front of the grave prior to execution, I was plucked from the group by an influential individual who knew me to be a talented violinist. And my devotion and love of playing the violin persisted, even under the most unimaginable circumstances the world has ever known. In 1944, I was confined in the infamous Flossenbürg concentration camp. The Flossenbürg concentration camp had about 11% Jews. The rest were from all over Europe, all nationalities and different religions. And I attempted to gain permission to play in the camp's orchestra, but at first I was refused by the orchestra's conductor on the basis of being a Jew. Jews were excluded from the orchestra. The conductor of the orchestra, who was German by nationality, was also a prisoner because he stood against the Nazi party and regime. Incidentally, he was also an anti-Semite. And there was also the main Nazi commandant of Flossenbürg, who would visit this camp 2 to 3 times a week. And every time he would visit, he executed a prisoner by shooting him dead. I must have lost my mind because I ran up to him and I said, "I am a violin virtuoso," as my mother used to call me. And the commandant looked at me and he said, "You come with me." My life was in his hands. I did not know when I would live finally found the conductor, and the commandant gave me the order to play with the orchestra. And within days after liberation from that concentrant, I obtained a violin. And soon thereafter, I joined the ex-concentration camp orchestra in Munich, Germany. My dream of studying with Ephraim Zimbalist came alive as I worked toward this goal. I left Germany for Geneva and became a student at the Geneva Conservatory. And I finally arrived in the United States in 1949 and soon fulfilled that lifelong dream by having an audition with Ephraim Zimbalist and being accepted as his student at the Curtis Institute of Music in Philadelphia. And after graduating from Curtis, my professional career began in 1954 with the Detroit Symphony Orchestra. Immediately following that year, I joined the Cleveland Orchestra for the next 4 years, from 1955 to 1959. I made my American solo debut in 1959 with the Cleveland Orchestra playing the Mendelssohn Violin Concerto. And after Cleveland, I spent 34 years with the Philadelphia Orchestra, soloing with them many times. And I retired as the Associate Concertmaster in 1993. Before my retirement, I was active a soloist in the United States, Europe, Asia, Mexico, South America. I've been able to pass along this art by teaching and through master classes. And I consider myself to be very fortunate to be able to have created a life of harmony and joy and wonderful friendship. Thing that ever happened to me. It gave me life. And for me, music is life. Music is hope. Music is peace.
Thank you. Thank you.